Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us for the Provost panel of Trojan Family Weekend 2020. I'll say good morning, a good afternoon, and good evening. We're very pleased to have people joining us from around the world. And while we can't be gathering in person, which is our traditional way of getting together for Trojan Family Weekend, what is unusual in these times is that we're able to share our comments and our thoughts around the world simultaneously using digital technologies. I hope that you're all safe and healthy wherever you are. Here at USC, we have been working enormously hard to create educational experiences for the students, sustaining the research programs that we have going on, and continuing to deliver excellent clinical care in our hospitals around the city and around the state. Our students, as you might imagine, are spending millions of hours online, participating in 8,000 different online classes that we have put together. And that only comes about through an enormous amount of hard work on the part of the faculty and the staff here at USC. And we're very proud of the programs that we're continuing to deliver. I have a few key people with me here today who are going to discuss the experiences of students and faculty during this unusual way of educating students. Joining us here today are Dr. Sarah Van Norman, who is our Chief Health Officer of USC Student Health, Winston Crisp, who's Vice President of Student Affairs, Andy Stott, who's Professor of English, Dornsife College of Arts and Sciences, and Dean of the Undergraduate Education and Academic Affairs, and Gabe Savage, President of the Undergraduate Student Government. We hope that you'll enjoy our conversation. Colleagues, since March, we've been mostly online, and this has changed dynamics between faculty, students, and staff, and I'm sort of interested in your perspectives of what has changed from a student perspective. Gabe, I'll start with you. What do you think's changed most?
Well, a whole lot has changed, Chip. And that's just from the daily interactions of students that I can speak to. And I know that there have been some difficulties for students, but I think that it's really important to draw attention to the support that students have received from the university as a whole, as well as individual faculty members. It's come down to a lot of, which faculty members have the understanding to meet students where they are. And that's proven to be really important and really valuable this semester. And so that has been for the better, absolutely. And of course, all the support from the parents at home too. I'm sure a lot of the folks watching are currently living with their USC student. And I know that that has made a difference for the better for all those students.
Great. Andy, what are you seeing from your perspective?
Well, good morning, everybody. So for us, we've had to completely reconfigure our education. And I think that's been incredibly instructive. On the one hand, we are a campus of residential living and in-person teaching, and that's our tradition, and that's what we know. But over a very short span of time, we've had to dive into the deep end of online learning, and it's really introduced, I think, some many intriguing perspectives on what we do. In particular, I think it's drawn attention to the individuality of student learners. And just as when we're on campus, the campus environment gives us some baseline expectations about how we conduct teaching, learning, and research, you're online, you really see everybody's individual differences. And so just as Gabe was saying, faculty are learning how to meet students where they are. That means not only in terms of their learning style, but also things like the technology they have access to, the learning spaces they have access to, where they are around the world, what time zone they're living in, what time of day it is when they're actually taking class or doing exams. And so we've had to retool things in this sort of much more adaptive and flexible way. And that's been really fascinating. And, the ways in which faculty have responded has been really intriguing because of those challenges.
Winston, you work with students outside of the classroom and provide them with different sorts of programming. And I imagine that that has changed enormously during this time when we're actually online. How do you see the change in student experience?
Thank you, Chip, and it has. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everybody wherever you are. Thank you for joining us. We very much appreciate you having us. I think it's been interesting. The start of a school year is a transition for students all of the time, notwithstanding this year. But given all that has happened this year, the transitions, the amount of change that has been presented to our students has been extraordinary. I will say that I think all in all, I think that our student body has adjusted quite well, though there have been a lot of adjustments that have needed to be made, like Gabe talked about and like Andy Stott talked about, everything from technology setups to where you can get a good workspace to where you're going to stay. So while it has been a tremendous transition and a tremendous challenge for people because it's not what everybody expected, I think a great amount of work has been done to try to help people to adjust, to move everything from career services to our new engagement site and things like that onto online to give our students opportunities to come together in ways when they can't physically at this time. I do think some have adjusted better than others, but I also think that that is natural. But we have a very intelligent, very resilient, very wonderful student body. And so all in all, I think the adjustment has gone fairly well.
It's good. So, Sarah, we're in this virtual world because of a health pandemic, and we now have students both locally who are living next to the campus and can't be participate in activities on campus, and students around the world. What are you seeing from a health perspective?
Yeah, so it has been a remarkable time in terms of health on campus. And at USC Student Health, we've really thought about how can we support the students that are living right around us in Los Angeles who have very immediate needs for healthcare, the students living in California, as well as the students across the nation and internationally. A lot of what dominates the conversation and the information is about COVID-19. How do we make sure students have good information about it? They have the tools and the skills they need to protect themselves, their families, their community, whether that's students locally who need access to testing, access to care if they contract it, but also students across the nation and internationally, making sure they have the information they need. Well, that's been very important and really a bulk of our work. The other thing we've really been focusing on is making sure that we make sure that students have access to the care they need for everything else. Are they getting their regular health checkups? Are they getting the other kinds of services they need? And importantly, making sure that we're continuing to support our community's mental health. I think that our students have shown remarkable resilience in unprecedented, uncertain times. We know students have faced, you know, financial challenges, health challenges as their own family, and just the impacts of you know, the loneliness and disconnection that can come with the world that we're living in. But our students, as I said, have shown remarkable resilience and support for each other. And so we're really focusing on thinking about how do we continue to support that? How do we make sure that students have access to informal and formal ways to get support when they need it as we move forward into what we hope is a return to more normalcy. But we know that the uncertainty will continue for months to come.
So we have maybe as many as 10,000 students who are living close to campus, and there are all these national stories about student partying, this leading to the spread of COVID and causing all sorts of problems. Sarah, I know that you're running a large testing program for all of the students who are local and can come in and be tested. What are the trends that you're seeing here at USC?
So the first thing I want to say is really just thank you to the USC students that we know that we have, you know, 10,000 or so students who are right around us and who have continued to live in our community and have really truly been remarkable in terms of their willingness and their understanding of how important it is for students to physically distance, to wear facial coverings, to get masks, to participate in all those public health activities that we need them to. I think what dominates the stories are the, you know, the campuses that have had student gatherings where there's been cases that have spread. And there certainly has been some of that at USC. But I really think that's been the exception. We also know that when we've worked with students who've been participating in gatherings, we've had students really understand that when we've had events where we've spread cases, the importance of participating in contact tracing and quarantine and isolation. At USC Student Health, we're testing about 3,000 students a week right now. We've tested over 22,000 students since the semester began. We did see a small uptick of cases, about slightly over 200 cases a week towards the end of August. But actually the week ending last Friday, we actually saw only 5 cases among our students that were tested. And so we think that's really due to, you know, the students coming in, getting tested. You lost me? Okay. We think it's really due to the students coming in and with getting tested regularly, following the public health guidelines, and when they are exposed, complying with quarantine and all those other things that are really challenging. So I think we want to continue that through the fall semester. And as we come back, as more students come back to campus in the future, really making sure all students understand the importance of testing and complying with those public health measures.
Okay. Winston, what are you seeing from your perspective from student affairs?
I want to add on a little bit, if I can, Chip, thank you to what Sarah said, because I agree completely. I think all in all, our students have been wonderful. And all in all, our students have done everything that we have asked them to, and we're very proud of them. I will say early on, as Sarah mentioned, right at the beginning of coming back to school, we were faced with a number of large gatherings, large party deals that we really had to aggressively try to get students to understand that this was not something that would be able to go on. But I do believe that we have not experienced those issues since then. And more of it has been just the challenges of students trying to live together and interact with each other in ways that make sense. So I do think that is clear. But the reason I mentioned this, and I think this is important, there's a lot of people out there that I've heard from students who fear that if they go and say, I have symptoms, or if they say, I've been to a gathering or something like that, and they have symptoms and they're worried about their health, that they're worried about coming or seeking help because they're worried about getting in trouble. I want to just say to everybody here, just very clearly, nobody's getting in trouble because they get sick. And every student who has any kind of symptom or anything like that needs to seek out assistance so that we can help them. There are behavior issues that come up from time to time with students that have to be dealt with, but we will never place anything like that in front of the health of our students. And it needs to be said very clearly, you're not going to get into trouble for cooperating with our health people who are trying to help you stay safe.
Yeah. So, Gabe, from your perspective, how's it going from the students who are gathered sort of around campus or throughout the community? What are you hearing?
Well, I'm not hearing too much because I'm not leaving my house personally. but what I can say is that I know, you know, when everybody first showed up in town, we had 10,000 new students in a couple block radius. And so I think that tick up in cases that we saw was all but expected. Because we had such a large influx of students come to a pretty small and tight space and then coexist there, I think that initial uptick was to be expected. But then after that, I think that students were able to recognize what's at stake here and understand that if they want to be back in the spring, if they want to return to normalcy as soon as possible, then what they need to do is not gather. And so I think that after students were able to come to terms with that, that we saw those cases go down. And of course, you know, thank you to the work of Winston for, you know, stepping in and making sure that everybody was on the same page about the university's policy on this. And I think it's really important for parents and students to understand alike.
So Andy, how do you perceive the sort of the faculty or the academic side of this, where we have students who are scattered around the world taking courses online in the middle of a pandemic? How do you believe this is playing out with the students and the faculty, that there are positive interactions? How do you imagine that?
Well, I certainly hope that positive. And, you know, my belief is that by and large, they certainly are. I mean, what we're seeing really is just a universe of invention. And it's really been exciting to see because, you know, in March when we were, we tilted to online, a lot of people were really responding in crisis mode and didn't have a very clear idea of what online learning was and the opportunities that it provided. But over the summer, the university provided an enormous amount of courses and sessions in online pedagogy. And we're very fortunate to have a number of skilled online teachers who've been teaching in that format for a number of years who could help to instruct people. And so people began to see very clearly what opportunities there were and the ways in which they could enrich their teaching. And I think that that's been wonderful because out of the crisis, it's really forced us to imagine some of our preconceptions and some of the ways that we were just maybe perhaps doing things out of habit. So some cases in mind would be things like lectures, right? I mean, we are set up at our institution with the type of teaching rooms we have to provide those sage on a stage type lectures in which somebody stands at a podium and, you know, sort of delivers 50 minutes of oratory. Now, is that a good learning environment? Well, you know, I think all of us in academia have known people who were really inspiring lecturers, but they've also known some pretty dull ones too. So in terms of information relay, I think online has forced us to look at the opportunities to deliver things in more efficient and effective ways, such as, you know, putting the lecture in an asynchronous format or putting it into 3, 5, or 15 minute chunks that students can, you know, sort of watch and absorb at their own pace. And then using the Zoom session, the synchronous live session, really for discussion and for understanding and working through problems and concepts and ideas. And that's a much more valuable way of using time than just listening to somebody and taking notes. Same with assessment. You know, one of the very first things we did was we sort of ran into some problems with the traditional way that we set and deliver exams. You know, a blue book exam in a proctored exam room in which people are really being asked to recall everything that they've absorbed during the course of the semester. Now, is that an effective way to really assess learning? And I think online learning has shown us that with the accessibility of information on the internet and the fact that answers can be easily Googled, and that it's really basically fundamentally impossible to control that environment when it's not on campus, we've been pushed into reconceiving assessment as ways of actually test critical thinking, right? And ways of piecing together and integrating information. And both of those things, I think the sort of revelations around lecturing, these new insights into assessment are actually really profound for the way we educate moving forward. So I think that's been a success.
So you believe, so what aspects do you think that will retain going forward? You make it sound as if we might actually want to retain some of the learning environments. So we've learned good things and we'll keep some of them when we enter a post-pandemic world.
I believe so. And, you know, I think that it will be down to individual faculty members and the extent to which we as a campus support those innovations. But I think, you know, we have students who obviously love the residential experience. That's what USC is all about. And, you know, we love our campus as faculty members too, and we want to be teaching in person. But some things like the flipped classroom, the access to new platforms, new technologies, ways of adapting learning to the individual learning styles of students, and also the timescales on which they're learning. You know, some people really like to cram. Other people like to provide themselves with a different pace, the way they absorb and digest the material. So I think it will provide us with more adaptive learning and more flexibility in the way we deliver our education. Plus, the technologies here here to stay, right? And, you know, if you get a great lecturer who's truly inspiring, I hope that continues in person. But for those of us who maybe have a tendency to watch their students nod off in the front row, then, you know, I'm going to be adapting to new technologies.
I see. So, Gabe, do you think there are things that we'll retain from the pandemic that will, you know, change the way we learn or change student experiences?
Absolutely. I mean, I think that one of the largest changes due to this pandemic is through accessibility for students with any sort of disability. And that's something that I want to make sure that the university retains when we do return to some, you know, sort of normalcy. You know, the fact that students can access class lecture afterwards, access transcripts of class lecture, I think is incredibly helpful. And I think that in some ways, you know, this online learning environment may have improved accessibility for students that were having problems with access before. And I think that, you know, finding ways to retain that when we do move back to normal is going to be really important for us moving forward.
Sarah, have you found things in delivering healthcare to students that we might retain after the pandemic is over? Useful lessons learned?
Yeah, absolutely. I think healthcare in general, both at college health as well as nationally, has really quickly transformed into really the delivery of telehealth. And at USC Student Health, we have transitioned to telehealth really quickly. While we have remained open and we continue to provide in-person services when they're appropriate, you know, well over half of our care now is provided via telehealth. And we've really had increased accessibility for students. That gives us the ability under current law to provide care to students living throughout the state of California, no matter where they are. And we're hopeful that federal and state laws will change over time to potentially allow us to provide care to students no matter where they're located. We think that's really important for our students just because of geographical reasons and continuity. But we also know for many services, for example, some mental health services, even when people aren't feeling well, the ability to receive care through a telehealth platform in many cases is more accessible, is more comfortable, and may actually be the preferred modality for students. So I think it's really transformed the field of college health as well as the rest of healthcare. And these are absolutely ways of service delivery that we're going to retain even when we move back to a more students living close to campus and in person.
So, Winston, I usually think of student affairs as about the student experience on campus and groups of students doing things. I'm wondering if, from your perspective, there are lessons learned that you will retain, or if it's just best to get through it and move back.
No, I think without question. I mean, now, to be clear, like most people, I'm very anxious and looking forward to having an open campus and to getting back to life. In some ways, as we have known it with this wonderful campus that we have. But at the same time, I think there are a number of things that we have either learned how to do or adjusted in our way of thinking that undoubtedly, like everybody else has said, will follow us beyond COVID. I can think of much of our online hosting ability. We've not only created sort of a completely new way to help students find each other and engage, but we are creating tools. We've created tools that allow them to create their own opportunities and their own instances. And I think that all of that technology that we have built to help students connect with each other, we will continue to use and we will integrate it and figure out how to integrate it better into our live life as we get back to it. Another thing that I think that we will certainly keep is this, I think as Andy described it, as sort of a forced creativity that we've been forced into, where we really had to begin to think out of the box about a lot of things. And that's gone across all of the schools and departments, and the level of collaboration and coming together across divisions and across schools that we have developed is even better than it was before. And I certainly think that we will retain that. And then I would also mention, Chip, that I think we have been working very hard. We still have a lot of work to do, but we have been working very hard on creating new avenues and new venues to allow us to communicate more effectively. And I think we'll continue to work on that, and we'll continue to use all of that as we go forward. So while we're really ready to get back to it, as I know everybody is, you do have to take crisis and make opportunity out of it. And I think there are a lot of things that we have learned through this that we will continue to use.
Okay. So Gabe, here we go. We're describing to you all of the efforts that we're working on to sort of enhance student experiences. How's it going? Are we doing a good thing? What do you think students wish that we were doing better, or what the faculty understood about what it was like to be online taking classes?
I mean, I think y'all are doing the best that you absolutely can given the circumstances. And I think that, you know, there have been a lot of improvements to the student experience since we started even this semester. I have felt the morale improve among students. But what I would say is that if there's one thing that I think students wish administrators and faculty understood a little more, was the effects of Zoom fatigue. And the fact that, you know, on Thursdays, I have 9 hours of class back to back. And after that, I'm not feeling inclined to jump on something to improve, you know, my student experience and go on a different Zoom meeting with more students. I just want to get away from my computer. And so I think that that's going to be one of the larger obstacles to tackle, is finding ways to make students feel connected with each other when they don't feel very connected with their screens, or maybe a little too connected with their screens.
So, Andy, what do you think about Zoom fatigue? Do you think the faculty are feeling that, or are they trying to load on more, get more screen time?
The Zoom fatigue is real, and it would be disingenuous of me to deny it. I mean, everybody's feeling it. And I think if I was, you know, I can't speak for the whole of USC faculty because it's such a large and diverse group. But if I would say one thing, I would ask that students understand that they're human too, and that they're also, you know, on their screens all day, and, you know, they have families, they have obligations in terms of care. They're also anxious about, you know, their loved ones and this virus. But I think the faculty are really student-centric, and they really care about learning. And I think if there have been any kind of issues with online classes in particular, it's about calibrating those polarities. On the one hand, you know, showing real concern and care for your students and being very flexible and, you know, understanding that this is a difficult period for everybody and not overburdening people, while at the same time upholding those standards of intellectual and academic rigor that you expect from USC. And, you know, you're paying your tuition, you expect to learn. So, you know, it's everybody's somewhere slightly different, I think, on that spectrum in terms of really balancing those elements. So I would ask that people show a little bit of understanding of that factor too, that we're all just trying to figure out where we lie or land on that spectrum of giving you the education you deserve and that you came here to get, while also showing a little bit of flexibility around things like, you know, deadlines and course load and all of that stuff.
So, Sarah, what do you have recommendations on what to do about Zoom fatigue and how we might actually help our students and our faculty think about that?
Yeah, so Gabe, I thank you for bringing that up, because I think it is so true. And as Andy mentioned, it's true for students, it's true for faculty, it's true for staff. I'm sitting here thinking, oh yeah, Gabe, I'm feeling Zoom fatigue too. But no, it really is true. And I think part of it is, one, just people acknowledging it. We are, I think, as a society, as a university, we've done a remarkable job of creating connections remotely. But it's okay to acknowledge that it's not the same as in-person contact. You know, physical contact, in-person contact is incredibly important for people. And while we know that in many circumstances that just isn't safe to get right now to gather in groups, I think everybody thinking about what they can do that's safe. So, you know, when I talk with students individually, I talk with them about, you know, do you have your 1 to 2 hours a day that you are outside, that you are in the sun, that you are disconnected from your devices? We know that within LA and in California, outdoor activity, and throughout a lot of the country, outdoor activity, physically distanced activity, walking with friends with facial coverings on is absolutely appropriate, and folks should do that. So I think people really have to be somewhat structured with their time away from the devices to really take that time out every day to carve out those opportunities to interact or to just be outside without the Zoom. So the basic tenets of, you know, sleep, of outdoor activity, of physical activity, all those things are probably more important now than they've ever been. And I think also, just as Andy mentioned, giving us, having that compassion for each other, the time to just acknowledge just how difficult that is, I think that's also incredibly important.
There's this interesting tension that is brought up that Andy mentioned about the desire for we're here at USC to be educated, to be prepared to move into the world after graduation, which talks about rigor of education. And then at the same time, we're struggling with how to balance, mental health and just life in general. And so there's, I'm curious about how we think about these things and actually go about balancing them. And Winston, what do you see sort of from a student affairs perspective when you're building programs that have to balance the need for, particularly with the undergraduate, to go from a state of dependency to independence over the 4 years, get a rigorous education, and at the same time sort of mature? And how does this online experience alter that?
It in some ways, I think that it changes it fundamentally. If we can, you know, hit the rewind button for a minute and go back in time sort of to pre-COVID, you know, the very focus of the place was getting everybody here and then finding as many ways as we could to provide as many different kinds of opportunities for them to engage with each other, to get to know each other, whether that be through their group activities or large activities, the social and entertainment functions. We've always been dedicated to sort of trying to provide opportunities and areas for our students to sort of gather together, to get to know each other, to collaborate, to work on projects. That obviously has had to change quite a bit right now, because you can't bring those gatherings together. And even if you did, we've got groups that the members are scattered all over the world. And so in some ways that adds a little bit of challenge, because the only way to really do some of these things right now continues to be online. Which obviously adds to the Zoom fatigue. So we really are trying to figure out how to help engage balance. We're working on figuring out how we can better use our outside spaces to allow safe opportunities once we have the ability to do that. We are, like I said, our wonderful folks in IT, and I have to mention the wonderful folks in IT. I'm not sure they ever get enough credit for the round the clock sort of work that they've been doing for 6 months now to try to keep us functioning every day. They may be some of the hardest working people that I'm aware of, but they're helping us to try to build new tools. For example, student organizations are tough. A lot of the purposes for some of the student organizations are about gathering, or about functions, extracurriculars and intramurals, and those things can't happen. And that leaves, in a lot of ways, some of our organizations just adrift, even trying to figure out if they still have a purpose in this COVID world. So we're really trying to introduce a lot of opportunities for our students to think about what they want to do and how they want to engage, to learn more about balance and relieving stress and ways they can get away from the computer, or even during the period of time, Gabe, for example, that you got yourself into with 8 classes in a row or whatever that was you said on a Thursday, taking quick breaks in between them and learning how to stretch and do different things like that just to try balance. I'm not sure that we have a true capability to get completely away from Zoom fatigue at the moment, because so much of what we have to do in front of these computers. But we do, and we are continuing to try to work on figuring out different ways to engage our students so that they have that engagement, even though we're missing that contact that Dr. Van Orman has been talking about.
Okay. So, Gabe, I'm interested from your perspective about this, the the world we find ourselves in, not just totally pandemic-related, but the value of a rigorous USC education, sort of based course, you know, based on courses and academic learning, versus the role of activities, let's say, outside the classroom, such as student government and the leadership functions that you've taken on. And I'm just interested from your perspective about how you think about balancing those and how we might think about an undergraduate education that gives you what you think you're interested in getting out of a USC undergraduate degree.
Well, it's one of my favorite things about USC. Is the fact that there's such a focus on holistic education, and the fact that, you know, I receive a rigorous academic education, but I also feel like I've grown so substantially since I first got here as a freshman. I'm learning how to adult, you know, in this university. I think with the current online situation, you are in a bit of a catch-22. But given that fact, the resources that have been made available to students, like Winston was saying, you know, learning how to properly balance, learning how to take breaks, learning how to manage your workload with a lot of stress. I think all of those resources have been provided by the university, and I think that's an incredible first step. And I think that it's so, like, can't understate the importance of that. In terms of myself, I mean, I know that balance is something that I'm currently still working on. I think a lot of student leaders are feeling that way, because I think in some ways, There's never been more work, you know, to be done for student leaders around campus, and yet their you know, their agency is reduced in some degree because of this online situation. And so, you know, I think that it's a difficult kind of problem for a lot of student leaders, but that USC has been providing all the resources necessary to help those student leaders in their positions.
So Andy, go ahead.
If I could add, I would just say that what also makes this challenging, and we haven't talked much about this yet, but obviously the pandemic is not the only thing going on in the world that our students are facing. The political landscape of the country, without regard to where you stand in it, is challenging. The social and upheaval that we have in the country is challenging. And so our students are challenged this year, the 2020, in ways that nobody saw coming and nobody imagined, that even make all of what we've been talking about vis-a-vis COVID even that much more complicated and add stress and strain to what we've got already. So this concept that we're talking about mental health and about wellness and about how we help our students find some balance is as critical a thing as we've got going on right now.
Andy, from your perspective on this balance between rigor and just sort of looking at life around us, how do you imagine what we mean by a rigorous education going forward? Do we need to rethink that which we need to pass on to the next generation, or is it the same standard, whatever I mean by rigor, in a particular class, whether it's a STEM class or a literature language class?
There's a lot to unpack there, Chip, but I think that the standards of rigor are determined by the faculty. You know, the curriculum belongs to the faculty. The courses and the learning objectives are decided by the faculty, and so the standards that that students are assessed against are really sort of deeply ingrained in what the disciplines themselves consider to be important and relevant at that time. Now, that doesn't mean that as an institution we should not be revising our curriculum often and reviewing it and making sure we're assessing it for quality and rigor. But those standards, you know, they're cultural, they're mutable, they change depending on where a particular discipline is in relationship to society, in relationship to the research that is currently being undertaken within those disciplines, and the directions in which disciplines are being taken by the leading academics and researchers at the top of their field. So it's a difficult question to answer, but I do think, without question, post-COVID, there will be a reassessment of many of the sort of key tenets of some of our disciplines to see whether we're still relevant. I think that this will be a moment. This will be one of those moments that come every couple of times in a generation that's a dividing line between before and after. And I think certainly, you know, we've talked already about the ways in which our pedagogy and our teaching may change. I think our disciplinarity might change, which is to say that I think our sort of fundamental paradigms about some of our disciplines may be on the brink of shifting, and that will be fascinating to see.
I certainly get the impression that it isn't a dividing line, that we're all, you know, before and after. We're actually during, and we're seeing a lot of changes already on campus. As we've all mentioned, faculty are being very creative in terms of how they're working with their students and learning new ways of assessing learning outcomes and how to transmit material and how to have a good time online, if you will. So I don't know that it's all going to come after COVID, if you will, but it seems to be actually occurring in real time, sort of around us. And that's why I'm sort of interested about what we've learned from the pandemic that we think will actually last. And so it sounds like it could be in health, in student affairs, actually in that which we're teaching and that sort of things. So I'm interested now in imagining what might happen when we come back and trying to think about what is it that you're looking forward to most. Just as an example, I sit in my office and I miss the sound of the skateboards going down Truesdale, you know, and maybe even when I'm outside dodging them on occasion. And it's actually the weaving in and out of people with the cell phone to the head that is amazing. I miss that demonstration of dexterity. But I also miss the Wednesday farmers market that exists. And so I'd be curious what each of you sort of would look forward to when you might actually come back to campus. We hope starting in the spring, but certainly in the summer or next fall is when we expect to be back in more full force. So Gabe, what is it that you would look forward to?
Oh man, this is really tough because there's so much. I'm also a huge fan of that Wednesday farmers market. It always is something to look forward to towards the middle of the week. But for me, it's something more general. It's just incidental interaction. I miss it so much. I feel like anytime I communicate with anybody nowadays, there has to be such a concerted effort put forth in reaching out or them reaching out to me, and it has to be with this purpose. What I'm excited to do is bump into a friend outside, you know, the Center for International Affairs, you know, or bumping into an old professor inside of Marshall and being able to say hi and catch up. You know, those are the things that I really miss, those little small incidental interactions that get you through the day. You know, those are what I'm looking forward to having again.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Sarah, what are you imagining?
Yeah, you know, like you, Chip, I'm on campus every day now because we're still open and we're doing stuff. And so many times I walk through campus now, and it's a really it's sort of sad, you know, and sometimes I feel a little sad when you look around and you see these buildings and the spaces and the beautiful USC campus and no one's there. And so I also miss the vibrancy and the liveliness and students weaving in and out on their skateboards and making me really worried that they're going to fall off, but that's okay. But you know, the other thing I think when I walk through campus now is I always try to remind myself, it feels like it's just waiting. And that's a really hopeful thing. I just remind all the students that are not here now that it's all here. It's all waiting. It's ready for everybody to come back. And so I look at the buildings and I just know everybody's going to be back. I don't know exactly when that's going to be. I know we're working as hard as possible to make sure we're ready when that happens. But it's all here, and it's ready for you.
Ready.
So that's what I'm looking forward to.
Very good. Yeah. Winston.
Thank you, Chip. I think I echo a lot of people, but what I will say is, you know, I've only been here a year, and so I only really got to experience the campus for the first, you know, half of that. And so, like most people, I miss getting back. But I tell you, I come to work very early. And usually when I get to campus, sometimes it's still dark, and other times the campus is pretty empty. My office sits over top of the plaza, and sitting at my desk, I can look out over the whole plaza, including Traveler and the statue, and see all of the hustle and bustle, and watch the university come to life over about an hour of watching the ROTC students run through on their physical training, watching the band show up to start practice, and watching tour groups and just the life of the university centering around the statue and the conversations and just that hustle and bustle. And then the skateboards, which I'm not sure I actually missed, Chip, that run through. But just that life, and I get to sit there and then go out and be in it. And like Gabe said, the incidental contact and the engagement of just running into students that I've not met yet, and them and either stopping them or having them stop me and having those conversations. That, I think, is what I miss. I think everybody misses that. But I also think I'm looking forward to having everybody back so that we can really continue to get to work on trying to rebuild and strengthen our sense of community, which I think has been frayed a little bit at times during this year with all that has been going on politically, socially, with the virus, and rebuilding those connections and the way we go about engaging with each other and listening and learning from each other. So I'm very much looking forward to that.
Andy.
So carrying on with the theme of skateboards, I have to tell you that I'm pretty sure that that's how I meet my untimely end. One of those skateboards has got my name on it, I'm pretty sure, so I don't know that I miss them that much. I miss the gatherings and the celebrations. You know, in academic life, our academic life is punctuated by celebrations, whether it be convocation or commencement. I'm the president of Phi Beta Kappa, and you know, that ceremony in the spring usually kind of is the kickoff for the ceremonial season. And I just really love those moments of celebration where we come together as a community and we recognize everybody's hard work and achievement and the wonderful things that our students have done. And what I really miss is when you get a large crowd and the speakers at the podium, and you can see those fingers rising, and you know that there's going to be like a huge fight on, and the whole crowd does it. You know, 4,000 or 5,000 people do it. And that sends chills through me. So I really can't wait to see that again in person.
Well, that's an interesting perspective. In that we are going to have football, we think, sometime this fall, right? That the Pac-12 has said that we can play, and with enormous amounts of testing. I'm sure Sarah could give us lots of details on that. But we'll be bringing back our football team. In fact, I think they start practicing today here on campus, and so we'll get our first game sometime in early November. I think our fear is that this will cause gatherings off campus, and that would lead to spread. So I'm imagining that one of the great joys will be watching the Trojans play football, but physically distanced and appropriately separated from one another is what we're all hoping for, so that we don't cause the spread. But that's where we get a lot of the traditions of those mass gatherings that you're describing, Andy, that are actually just wonderful, the marching band and that sort of thing. So I agree with that 100%. So it sounds like we all have great desires to get back together. What I'm hoping we're transmitting to the audience that we're chatting with right now is that we are committed as an institution to the rigorous education, to the content of the courses, the transmission of knowledge, to continuing to do research. And at the same time, we're very interested in taking the student who joins us as a freshman and preparing them to be successful when they graduate. They learn a deep body of knowledge, they in their major and in their discipline and in the core education we provide. provide them. They learn to interact with one another. And even during pandemic times, the activities that we've described keep them safe, keep our students safe, keep our faculty and staff safe, provide interactions online, and we hope more and more in person as we begin to move through this pandemic. And then the rigorous intellectual life that we have here at USC that we're able to share through the traditions that we have and through the coursework and the ceremonies that we have. And this Trojan Family Weekend is indeed one of those traditions that we have. And I'm so pleased that you came together. I want to thank each of the panelists, Sarah, Winston, Gabe, Andy, for being with us and participating. And I want to thank everybody in the audience for being here. And, you know, all right, so get ready. We can raise our hands and say, oops, fight on. Thank you very much, everybody. Yeah. Thank you.